I call to order this meeting of the Coweta County Board of Education, Agenda 807, 6:30 p.m., Tuesday, February 13th, 2024. Please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance, followed by a moment of silence. Thank you. You may be seated. Is there a motion to approve the agenda?
So, second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Motion carries 7-0. Recognitions, Dr. Horton.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. At this time, I'm going to call on Public Information Officer, Mr. Dean Jackson, to bring your recognition.
Thank you, Dr. Horton. We only have one recognition tonight. That's with Arnold Middle School. We have a great group of students from Arnold with us, many of whom we met a little bit earlier. But I'm going to call on Patrick Sullivan, principal of Arnold Middle School, to introduce our core business tonight.
Well, good evening, everyone. My name is Patrick Sullivan, and I am the proud principal at Arnold Middle School. It is my pleasure to be here tonight with a wonderful group of students and teachers. We're going to highlight some of the great things our students are learning at our school. I'm here again with several of my staff members and a great group of sixth grade students. Staff members with me here tonight are Ms. Jillian McDonald.
Say hello.
Lindsay Feely, Delaney Ritchie, Kim Bocchino, Michelle Carrera, and LaWanda James. Recognizing that the five-year strategic plan for Coweta County emphasizes that we provide our students with instructional strategies that provide life-applicable skills and experiences for learners to develop a growth mindset, we at Arnold Middle School have identified hands-on learning and using real-world connections through a STEM focus for this year's school improvement plan. As part of this focus area, all of our teaching staff, as well as support staff, are working towards earning Coweta County STEM recognition this year. They are doing this by designing and implementing high-quality, hands-on STEM lessons to use with all of our students. Ms. McDonald is here with her sixth grade students this evening to share just one example of the work that is being produced by our students to help accomplish this goal. Ms. McDonald.
Good evening, my name is Jillian McDonald and I teach a wonderful group of students at Arnold Middle School. This year, one of our main focuses is in preparing our sixth grade students to utilize their verbal and nonverbal skills across a variety of settings so they can develop life-applicable skills in real-world applications. We recognize that communication is an essential life skill for our students that will help them become successful when they transition into the workforce. In addition to communication being part of the ELA curriculum, our sixth graders are working on addition and subtraction of multi-digit decimals. Rather than practicing these skills in isolation, I provided a learning activity where our classroom was turned into a restaurant called the Candy Cane Cafe. Our restaurant ran for one full school day and was staffed by the students in our program. Teachers, staff members, and community members signed up for 30-minute reservations where they could be seated at one of our three tables. Students took on the roles of host, waiter, and chef in order to bring quality service to their teachers and community members that attended. Students practice these skills needed, specifically focusing on using appropriate eye contact, adequate volume, and clear pronunciation when speaking. Students also practice using the mock register via an iPad and making the correct change for when customers pay their bill. The goal of this activity was to empower our students by providing an opportunity for them to practice their communication skills in a controlled environment where preparation was tailored to each student's needs and feedback was able to be given immediately. Students were provided with scripts tailored to their appropriate job so that they could focus on the practice verbal and nonverbal skills. We wanted to ensure that this lesson was connected to the real world by providing a vocational experience, giving our students the tools needed in order to navigate the world successfully, both through participating in their community and contributing to their own well-being. We've put together a short video so that you can get a better look into the event. Okay, look, it's on the TV over there. We have five students coming up to speak that have taken some time to think about both about how their daily life at school as well as this event has impacted their education. They have been practicing and will be coming up individually to share their experiences.
Okay, ready? Okay, come right here. Okay, ready? You're gonna talk, look, mouth in there.
R.
No, right here.
In Miss McDonald's class, we are asked to apply ourselves each day by doing work, learning new skills, begin kind every day, and loving ourselves in our every day. Friends every day.
Okay, ready, Jackson? Hold on. No, hold on.
That's the thing. I think I most about this class making friends and learning new skills and feeling happy.
Good job.
This activity taught me how to talk to people kindly. Practicing the job helped me because if I get a job when I'm older, I will already know what to do. Having a job is hard because I have to learn and try new things.
This activity taught me how to subject context to the real world by not being shy so I can talk to people. I learned what to do with my mouth and voice when I'm working. If I talk loudly at people, I will not be a good worker. But if I talk clearly and calmly, they will not fire me and will like me. And also, I can count money like a real job can do. A man would have me do.
Good job. Yeah. Hold on. Okay, go ahead.
my basketball coach and go all the way to the high school, working with computers, going to the play the piano and making music.
I can't tell you how proud of these kids and my teachers are. They do such a wonderful job. And they put together their own speeches. They wrote their own speeches. So for them to get up here and do that just meant the world to me. So thank you for the opportunity. Do you have any questions?
I don't have any questions, and I don't want to spoil it by saying anything. They're incredible. And thank you. Students, you are awesome. To our teachers, thank you for pouring into them every day. Appreciate you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Is there a motion to approve the minutes of January 9th, 2024?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Any abstentions? Mr. DeBose is abstaining. Carried 6-0. Action items, Group 1, Dr. Horton.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The first action item I have for you in Group 1 is to approve the 2024 Sick Leave Bank Committee. As required by board policy, the board annually approves a list of nominees to serve on the Sick Leave Bank Committee. The following is a list of nominees: Mike Harris from Worth Central Office, Sean Dye, Jefferson Parkway Elementary, Tony Vinson, Welch Elementary, Holly Perez from Blake Bass Middle, Susie Bott from Worth Operations, Charlotte Hollins from East Coweta Middle School, and Allison Hurston from Noonan High School. Mr. Chair, I recommend approval.
You've heard the recommendation of the superintendent to approve the 2024 Sick Leave Bank Committee. Is there a motion for approval?
So moved. Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Motion carries 7-0.
The next item I have for you in Group 1 is to approve the FY 2025 RESA membership agreement. The Coweta County School System partners with West Georgia RESA for educational services for improvement of instruction. This contract is for FY 2025 between West Georgia RESA and the school system in the amount of $80,640. Mr. Chair, I recommend approval.
You've heard the recommendation of the superintendent to approve the FY 2025 RESA membership agreement for $80,640. Is there a motion for approval?
So move.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Motion carries 7-0.
The next item I have for you is to approve Arbor Springs PTA request to install play cubes and a poly climber on the upper grades playground. Arbor Springs Elementary School requests approval for the purchase of materials and installation to replace old playground equipment for the school. Project will be funded by the Arbor Springs Elementary PTO. Total project cost for materials and installation is $24,563. Requirements of board policy FEAE have been met and supporting documentation is attached. Mr. Chair, I recommend approval.
You've heard the recommendation of the superintendent to approve Arbor Springs Elementary PTA request to install play cubes and a poly climber on the upper grades playground. Is there a motion for approval?
So moved. Second.
Is there any discussion? All those in favor? Motion carries 7-0.
The next item I have for you in Group 1 is to approve a contingency change request to add permanent irrigation for BP3 at Noonan High School. Approval is requested for a contingency change request to add permanent landscaping irrigation in BP3. The construction documents call for temporary irrigation to be provided for landscaping in Bid Package 3. The request covers the cost to install the system underground, provide irrigation controls, and provide the required meter and backflow preventer for a permanent system. Total contingency adjustment amount is $74,868. The change order proposal and supporting documentation is attached. Mr. Chair, I recommend approval.
You've heard the recommendation of the superintendent to approve a contingency change request to add permanent irrigation for BP3. Is there a motion for approval?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? I just have a quick question. This is, just to confirm, this is going to be in the front of the school?
Yes, sir.
On the Grange?
Yes, sir.
And then just will we wait to begin with this project until we conclude the front of the school, or will this project begin immediately?
At the front of the school, they're getting it on grade now. Typically, landscaping is one of the last things that will go in prior to us getting the CO and occupying the building. So just a rough estimate, I would say you're probably looking toward the end of the school year, into June, before we'd probably be doing any irrigation there.
Thank you. All those in favor? Motion carries 7-0.
The next item I have for you in Group 1 is to approve a contingency change request to replace the canopy lighting in the car rider area at Noonan High. Approval is requested for a contingency change request to replace the under canopy lighting on the existing car rider canopies at Noonan High School. The underside of these canopies will be painted dark bronze. The new light fixtures will be installed on the underside of the canopies. Total contingency adjustment amount is $20,962. Change order proposal and supporting documentation is attached. Board members, one thing I will mention prior to my recommendation, these are the canopies that were still standing after the tornado. So they have, I think we installed these canopies probably back in, I think we renovated over there, 08, 09, somewhere in that time frame. Part of the reason for this change order is the new campus will have LED lights, which are new since 08, 09. And if we leave these lights, we're going to have two different color lights. That's one portion of it. The other piece of it is, for me, the new LED lights are much more energy efficient. So we want everything to match, and with the energy efficiency, that is the reason that I bring this change order to you. So I do recommend approval.
You've heard the recommendation of the superintendent to approve a contingency change request to replace the canopy lighting in the car rider area. Is there a motion for approval?
So moved.
Is there? Thank you. Any discussion? All those in favor? Motion carries 7-0.
The next item I have for you in Group 1 is to approve an intergovernmental agreement between the school system and Coweta County for radio tower space. Approval is requested to enter to an intergovernmental agreement between Coweta County and the school system for radio tower space. Board members, this is the Sonoy Tower on the far east. You remember last month we did Canongate. This month we have Sonoy, just trying to make sure that we have sufficient coverage throughout the county for our transportation radio system. So this will help us do that. So I recommend approval.
You've heard the recommendation of the superintendent to approve the intergovernmental agreement between Coweta County School System and Coweta County, Georgia for radio tower space. Is there a motion for approval?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Motion carries 7-0.
The next item I have for you in Group 1 is a request to add exploring audio, video, broadcast, and film to the curriculum. We're recommending the addition of the CTAE Middle School Exploratory course, exploring audio, video, broadcast, and film for 6th through 8th grade students at our middle schools. The addition of this course will provide a hands-on learning environment for middle school students to explore careers in our growing local film, technology, and broadcasting industry. Additionally, these courses will support our commitment to prepare students for current and future high-need occupations and post-secondary learning opportunities in our region, and will be taught in coordination with the CEC audiovisual broadcasting and audio sound recording pathways for high schools. This 9-week exploratory course will be in addition to the existing menu of connections options for 6th through 8th grade students. The addition of this course also supports our commitments to the programs offered at the Central Educational Center. It's in alignment with our CTAE Advisory Board goals to increase pathway completion rates at the high school level. Students who successfully complete this course will be prepared for the audio, video, broadcast, and film pathways offered at the CEC upon entering high school, and the courses qualify as beyond the core learning opportunities for middle school, college, and career readiness performance index. Board members, I will point out, students here tonight producing our board meeting, the audio and video are products of our program over at CEC. You have seen and heard a lot throughout the state about encouraging students to get plugged into those career interests at an earlier age. This course for middle schoolers will support doing just that. And I know there's been a lot out there, especially locally, related to our growing film industry. So there's certainly a need for students to leave our schools prepared to enter into audio-video broadcasting. So with that, I recommend approval.
You've heard the recommendation of the superintendent to request to add exploring audio and video broadcast and film to the curriculum. Is there a motion for approval?
So move.
Second.
Is there any discussion?
I have one quick question.
Go ahead, Ms. Dees. I'll go next.
Will we have a teacher for this program, or will we hire someone for this program?
The middle school that we're planning to expand this program at first already has the capacity to do the course, yes.
And I just wanted to add, I was at an elementary school just yesterday, and the media center specialist was pointing out to me that they have the students produce like a little short news program and that they're interested there. So you whet the appetite in elementary school, perfect class for them in middle school if they want to explore that interest. So thank you for everyone for putting this together and bringing this to the students.
All those in favor? Motion carries 7-0.
The last item I have for you in Group 1 is to approve the purchase of one 83-passenger IC International bus. Approval is requested for the purchase of one 83-passenger IC International bus for $137,000. This purchase would be paid from the state bond funds of $88,110 and SPLOS funds of $48,890. The bus is at the state contract price. Board members, a couple things here. We did have, you may have the question, why are we only buying one bus? We typically buy more at one time. We had enough state money left over for one bus. Another question that may come to mind is typically we buy 72 passenger buses. This is an 83. So it's a little bit bigger bus for a reasonable price with some state money left over. So that's the reason we want to go ahead and try to get this bus while we can. So I recommend approval.
You've heard the recommendation of the superintendent to approve the purchase of one 83-passenger IC International bus. Is there a motion for approval?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Farmer. Any discussion? All those in favor? Motion carries 7-0. There are no action items in Group 2. Moving to Group 3, trips.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. At this time, I'll call on Dr. Guy to bring you trips. Dr. Guy.
Thank you, Dr. Horton. The principal of East Coweta High School requests permission for the Winter Guard to participate in the Southern Association for Performance Arts at the University of Tennessee, Chattanooga, in Chattanooga, Tennessee, on April 5th through the 6th, 2024. The cost to the school system will be for transportation via a Coweta County school bus. There will be no school days missed. The principal of East Coweta High School also requests permission for the United States Marine Corps Junior Reserve Officer Training Corps program to take students to a 4-day orientation camp at Parris Island, South Carolina, from June 3rd through June 7th, 2024. There are no school days that will be missed, and there is no cost to the school system.
I recommend approval.
You've heard the recommendation of the superintendent to approve the two East Coweta High School field trip requests. We'll just do them together. Is there a motion to approve both trips?
So moved. Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? All those in favor? Motion carries 7-0. All right. Superintendent's report, Dr. Orton.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. At this time, I'm going to call on Mr. Keith Chapman to bring your budget report, sales tax, and our audit report from the year ending June 30th, 2023. Mr. Chapman.
On the surface of our board report, it looks like a bad month. We're over budget right at $2.2 million, but that's due to passing along the bonus from the state. Those expenditures will be covered with state funds and some remaining ESSER funds, so our bottom line at the end of the year will not be impacted by that. Sales tax, continue to see good collections there, just under $3.9 million. The growth year over the year has slowed a little. It's down to 3.4%, but still nice growth. I'd like to introduce Demetria Wright with Maldon & Jenkins to present our audit. Yep.
Thank you. There we go. Good evening, everyone. Again, my name is Demetria Fluellen. I am a senior manager at Maldon & Jenkins CPAs. I am here to present the FY23 audit on behalf of Hope Pendergrass, who is the partner of the firm on this job. So I want to go ahead and jump into the results of the audit. So typically I look at the annual financial report in two sections. So we have the financial section, and then we also have the compliance section. So in the financial side, we issue an unmodified opinion, which is a clean opinion, which is the best opinion you can get. We also reported no findings. And then on the compliance side, anytime a government has over $750,000 in federal awards, a single audit is required. And we determined that the single audit was ESSER, the ESSER monies and child nutrition cluster. Again, those were clean. We had no compliance issues. And so I want to take a moment to say good job to the finance team. They're always ready. We come in, we get what we need and get out. And it's really a pleasure to work with Mr. Latimer and his team. And I want to take a moment to talk about some of the general fund highlights for the year ended FY23. So the general fund, there were approximately $299 million in revenue and other financing sources. And then there were approximately $297 million in expenditures and other financing uses. So that's about a $2 million increase from the prior year. So fund balance went from $47.5 million to $49.9 million. So I did the math, and that's about 2 months of fund balance as of 6/30 that you had in fund balance. And that's a really good thing because at that time, at 6/30, that's one of the leanest periods of the year because it's right before taxes are billed. You're gonna need that strong balance as the cost for state health benefits continue to increase. And let's see. So I have this auditor discussion and analysis. I believe that this was shared with you electronically. And all it is it talks about who we are as a firm, what services we provide. There's a highlight of the general fund, revenues and expenditures, kind of what I just talked about, and along with other things that are communicate that we have to communicate in the back, we talk about future GASB pronouncements because I mean we want to be abreast of what's going on and we also want to keep our clients abreast of what's coming for the GASB pronouncements. So that's about all I have. Do y'all have any questions at this moment?
No questions. Just want to expand a little bit on what you said, Mr. Latimer, Mr. Chapman, all of our folks in financial services. Appreciate all of your hard work. We all know that, you know, with 3,000 employees, it takes all 3,000 of us being committed to compliance and internal controls and making sure that we're good stewards of that which we've been entrusted with. So thank you to all of our employees for their diligence in making sure that we're in good financial shape. And I'm proud to say that we continue to be in good financial shape. I do want to point out one thing. Mr. Harris is going to test you a little bit. If you go to the website to the main page, click on financial information, the second bullet there. If anyone's ever interested, you can go and you can see at least the last 10 or 12 years of our audit reports. You can see the last 10 to 12 years of our SPLOST audits and audit reports and any budget information from the better part of the last 10 to 12 years. So I always like to point out that that information's there for anyone to see and appreciate everyone's hard work to make sure that our system continues to be on very solid financial footing. So thank you for coming tonight.
All right, thank you.
And Dr. Guy, staff and student attendance and board goal report.
Thank you, Dr. Horton. For the fifth attendance reporting period, the school with the highest staff attendance was Arbor Springs Elementary School. The highest student attendance in the program area was Central Educational Center. High student attendance in elementary school, Arbor Springs Elementary. Highest middle school attendance was Madras Middle School. And highest high school student attendance, Northgate High School, home of the Vikings. This month, Dr. Jillian Andrew will update the board on the upcoming strategic waiver contract renewal process.
Good evening. Thanks. So we attended a webinar with the state a couple of weeks ago, a little more than a week ago, so that they could update us on the new process. We are going to apply for, or all districts will apply for, a six-year strategic waiver contract. We will submit as a county our application in the platform by the end of March. The state will provide us with feedback in April so that we can present our contract to you during the May board meeting for approval. And then the state will approve, review and approve all strategic waiver contracts June 13th.
Dr. Andrew, is that standard for to be a six-year waiver for Dr. Horton?
Traditionally, they have been five-year waivers. The state, the Department of Education is working to bring uniformity across the state so that different districts aren't on different time schedules related to their waivers. Board members, you may recall several years ago, the state made the move to a change in governance for school systems, and school systems had to pick whether they were going to become a charter school system, a strategic waiver school system, or a status quo school system. So basically, at that time, the district chose to become a strategic waiver school system. What that means is, under Title 20 of the Georgia Code, which is all of the education laws, it means that there are certain laws that you can waive within Title 20, utilizing that flexibility for increased accountability. It also means that there are certain Department of Education rules that you may be able to waive, and in exchange for that flexibility, you get increased accountability. So we've been for the last several years under a strategic waiver. We are looking now at the new application process, so the staff will get together and we'll look at what we currently waive, what we might want to waive in the future, what we maybe haven't used that we may not want to use in the future related to strategic waivers as we plot out a course. I did tell some staff members last week, this is a great time for us to be involved in this process, because you may remember we're also undergoing a strategic plan update right now. We're looking at our plan for 2024 through 2029, and we'll be bringing you that strategic plan here in June for your approval. So those things mesh together very nicely, and it's a great opportunity for us to see what flexibility we'd like, to assess where we are from an achievement and accountability standpoint, and to chart the course with our strategic plan for 2029 and with this through 2030. So it's a really good place for us to be. You're going to hear a lot more about where we are achievement-wise and our strategic plan at our upcoming whole board training on March 20th. And then this will be a nice segue as we carry through the strategic waiver and the strategic planning process. So thank you.
Yes, thank you very much.
All All right. Next item I have for you, board members, is the facility and construction report. Northgate is still lingering. To Mr. Cheek's dismay, he's ready to get that off of there, but we're still waiting on a little bit more information to close out the Northgate project, waiting on a metal roof reinspection up there. Softball field houses, if you've been by each of the three schools, the high schools, you can see those projects are ongoing as weather permits. I think we have block going up at East Coweta High School, did some slab footing pours late last week at Noonan High School. Northgate, they're pretty much finished with the re-roof on the existing building there. The band tower at East Coweta has been delivered and erected. We're expecting delivery here in the next week or so for the towers at Northgate and Noonan High. Talked a little bit about Noonan High School earlier, BP3, the front landscaping or the front lawn there, not landscaping, but the lawn is on grade at this point. They're working to, hopefully, as weather permits, within the next couple weeks to begin sidewalk installation on that front grade there. Exterior windows have all been installed. Installation of drywall continues at multiple locations inside the building. Ceiling grid and light fixtures are being installed in classroom wings. And if you go into the kitchen, the grease traps are being installed and exhaust hoods are being installed. Making great progress there, still on schedule for completion this coming July. Last item I have for you, board members, is just an item for information. It's regarding qualifying fees for 2024 Board of Education district elections. Georgia law requires that the governing authority of any county or municipality set and publish qualification fees for elections no later than February 1st. Qualifying fee for Board of Education seats has been set by the Coweta County Board of Commissioners at 3% of the board member's gross compensation, since this is the minimum allowed under Georgia law. Based on the board member's salary of $11,400 per year, fee's been calculated to be $342. Fee was set at the December 19, 2023 Board of Commissioners meeting, and attached is the notice of those qualification fees. I believe qualifying is coming up for the three seats that the board will have up in May. Qualifying comes up, I believe, the first week of March. Just wanted to have that out there for you just as information. Mr. Chair, that's all I have.
Thank you, Dr. Horton.
Yes, sir.
There are no public comments this evening. But I will thank everyone for being in attendance both online and in person. Really great to see you all here tonight. So thank you. We're moving on to board comments.
I would like to just say, I think one young lady is still here from Arnold Middle School, and just wanted to tell her that she did a fantastic job serving us tonight and hosting us. Yeah. You were so kind and so sweet, and we enjoyed our dinner, and thank you. Thank you so much. It was fantastic.
And I'd like to second what Ms. D said. Chloe, you did a great job seating us, and thank you for being here.
Yes, thank you. Okay. Is there a motion to approve to enter into executive session to discuss personnel, real estate, and potential litigation?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? All those in favor? Motion carries 7-0.